find ourselves speaking sloppily, if you would, with lots of pronouns, but we're catching ourselves. So we haven't gotten to the point to where we are not speaking sloppily, but we are aware when we are, and then I go back and I fill in those pronouns with names like Elizabeth instead of her or she or whatever. So we're progressing. I don't know how you all are doing it in your classroom, but I think that we have heard from our observations, from the mentors' observations, Paula and Sandy and McLemore and Browning, when we go out to the classroom, we are seeing the same thing that a lot of principals are. And it's not enough of this, not enough questioning, and not enough higher level questioning. And I'm thinking that we probably need to go back to that Webb's matrix.
Depth of knowledge.
The depth of knowledge, and look at those verbs. And when you're thinking about, you know, your instruction, that you think about what kind of question that you're asking them, because it is very compelling. May came in with a story that was kind of frightening to her, more so than me, but in her high school science class, the kids were saying that the producers were the, no, that the, how did they say that?
The
plants were the primary producers or something like that. And I said, and she asked them why, because you've got to get into kids' brains, and you want to tell them what they said.
Because of the first ones, they're primary.
In a food chain. They have to understand the food chain first before you go to a food web. So in a food chain, for some reason, they're thinking that. And I said, well, wait a minute, that's, I think, an elementary teach. So she asked her teachers, and they said, well, the middle school teacher said,
so they asked them, how did you guys handle it? Did you guys brush through it, or how hard did you hit ecology? They told me, oh, we just brushed through it because they taught it in third, fifth grade, and seventh grade. And I went, okay. Well, I just got told my draft of the primary consumers because they're the first.
Yeah, she's still twitching. That star apology coming up. She's only been there this semester teaching. So I think that kind of those kind of stories, they bring us back to what good instruction is about. And a lot of it has to do with the questioning that we do with students to find out if they really do understand it and what kind of justification do they have for it. So apparently this is a huge issue that we're seeing in the classrooms, that we're seeing too much of this and not enough of this. This is what principals also tell us.
This was asking in talents.
Well, I had a sign.
Their backs are to you.
I have a professional question. What would be an appropriate response or direction to go when you hear from other teachers for science, I'd say, well, we hit the teats.
What does that mean?
My response in my head, the problem I'm having is, well, what did the teats ever do to you that you have to beat them up?
That's probably not the right response.
Right.
So
that's what I mean.
Explain what you mean by hitting. Tell me what you mean by hitting. So I have two questions about this story with Renee. Number one, I can understand why the kids think it's primary, because primary grades are first, second, third, PKK. So that word primary to them might mean early.
Someone told me that they had primary in there.
Oh,
primary first.
Yeah.
Okay. And then I went to the second word, consumer.
Yeah. So as a math person, not a science person, it would make sense to me, but I do understand that concept, so I'm not quite that bad. And then the second one is, did they really teach it in third, fifth, and seventh, or did they hit on it?
Yeah. In seventh, they told them about it.
They told.
Those are not, those were not.
Sure, there's some activities y'all do with those, right?
There, 40% of instructional time in science is supposed to be investigations, not just activities, not just concrete, but investigations. So concrete and investigations. And that's, again, that's what we're seeing. We're seeing worksheets, we're seeing lectures, we're not seeing good instruction in classrooms, and I've got student teachers, I'm not talking about, you know, y'all, okay, I'm talking about every time we're going out. And this is what, you know, this is what principals are saying, and this is why we're seeing the results that we're seeing on STAR and the kind of things that, that you're talking about. I mean, it's all about the basics. In fact, we will not place any more student teachers in a variety of classrooms that we have found a pattern of not good instruction, one of which is alternative certified teachers. We will not place any more in alternative certified teachers. However, there are exceptions like Laura. Laura's all cert, but Laura went through, Laura, you listen here?
Yep.
Laura went through that NSTA, what is it called, science teacher?
It's the same
you're
one
wrong,
Kim
same
did.
One Kim's in, what's it called?
New Science Teacher Academy.
New Science Teacher Academy. So, you know, it's not that we can't learn to teach better, but we really have to focus on it and be, to pay attention, go back to those best practices. And if, you know, if you see yourselves doing things that you know are not best practices, stop and think, why is that happening? You know, there's a lot of reasons it's not in your control, but a lot of it is in our control.
So one of your primaries should be added to our dictionary is, you know, common words and how it's used in science. You know, we have that little section here. This is just to you.
Yeah, but you know what that brought to mind, Renee is my latest student teacher. We've changed our lesson plan format as we've kind of gone through. And one of the things that we have in that lesson plan, and I may make a copy so you can kind of see, it's very in-depth. We have a section that says science vocabulary and then general vocabulary that you need to teach. For example, chair, you know, be a general vocabulary word, so you need to teach that because that's part of this lesson, even though it's not science, so it's kind of a general one. And we have added that to it, and my student teachers tell me it really helps them.
So they can understand it's a science word, and elsewhere it means something else.
No, not even that. Not even that. We haven't gone that far. Yeah. Okay. Write that down, Denise, with you, so I don't forget.
Just did.
Okay.
So y'all have a post-test, I think, coming up soon. So we're going to kind of do some activities that remind you what we've been doing this whole long year. And that'll be after our first initial activity this morning. So just to remind you, this is instrumental understanding. Instrumental understanding, I'll tell you, is not a good thing. So let me get my little sticks out. Mary Lou, tell me what you think instrumental understanding is, since I just said it is not really a good thing.
Mary Lou.
Oh, I'm sorry. I didn't hear
it. It is not patterns, but that's a good guess. You want a phone friend?
Brandon?
Since it's not a good thing, maybe understanding the basic concept of something and not how it works together.
You are very, very close. This is your brain, and these are concepts that you have learned in the past. What do you notice about these concepts, Pam?
There's no connection.
There's no connection. So that's instrumental learning. So if we go on to there's a new idea. Okay, the red dot is a new idea your teacher is teaching. Is it connected to anything yet? So suppose the teacher connects it to this concept, but does not connect it to these. You're still not going to have a really rich understanding of that new concept because you have not connected it to other things, one of those being real world. So this is relational understanding. What do you notice, Ashley? That Ashley.
It's just a one-to-one. One dot's connected to one dot to one dot.
And
except for the red dot, it's connected to four other things.
Yeah, so this new idea has been connected to several prior concepts that have been learned. It cannot be connected to every single thing in the world, but it is connected to as many things as possible. So So we did this in the summertime. Remember, we talked about this in the summertime. I wanted to bring this back and remind you that as you're teaching, you need to connect this to a whole lot of things. So then we have conceptual knowledge. You should all know what conceptual knowledge means. It's written up there. So Elizabeth, what does it mean? Where are you, Elizabeth? There you go.
Conceptual knowledge is logical relationships, representations.
Don't read it. I want your own words.
Conceptual knowledge is the ability to apply your understanding.
That's part of it. Yes, that is part of it. So that's opposed to procedural knowledge. And Amanda, what is procedural knowledge? Amanda is. She's not here today. Kim.
Knowing how to do the function, but not necessarily apply the information.
Can you give me an example?
Understanding terms for algebra, but not knowing how to shuffle the equation around.
Okay. Can you give me another example, Melissa?
So, for example, how to solve a two-step or a multi-step equation.
Mm-hmm.
And for me, I'm very abstract, so that works for me, and I just know there's certain rules so I can solve one. Necessarily know why I can do what I can do. I just know that I can do it.
Okay. Rochelle, you had your hand up?
Yes, like multiplying using like algorithm.
Mm-hmm.
You know, just knowing the steps, you know, times, carry,
mm-hmm.
You know, without understanding why you're carrying that.
Yeah. But we don't carry anymore. We regroup, remember?
Right.
So people still say carry. I still say it occasionally when I'm not thinking what I'm doing. About what I'm doing, but we regroup. We don't carry, because when you carry, you're carrying something.
Mm-hmm.
Okay? Jen, you had your hand up.
I just wonder if we teach math in a way that they understand the process but don't even know why they're doing it or what they can do with it.
Yes.
How can be used as a tool to figure out
exactly. And that is procedural, and that we need to bump that up to conceptual understanding.
I have to laugh about this. Okay, Kendra?
Can we get some science examples in here?
Can we? You science people?
No.
Yeah, you have to.
Yes, ma'am.
Not knowing like the food chain, the order, but not necessarily knowing the flow of energy or what meaning what.
Okay. So, Jen?
I don't know, am I right? It's like the force thing, and they know if they're actually acting upon a force and doing a force.
It's work.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
Work.
Yeah.
Yeah. Teamwork. Teamwork. So, our goal is to teach which kind of knowledge, to incorporate which kind of knowledge in our teaching.
One.
Brenda. Conceptual. Very important. Very, very important. So, just a reminder. You always start a new concept with manipulatives. And when I say you always start with manipulatives, some of my pre-service teachers get confused and they think that every single day you have to start with manipulatives. You start with manipulatives with new concepts. Once they have the new concepts, then you can move to the pictorial and then to the abstract. So once they can explain multiplication to you in various ways and they understand why you regroup or partial products or something like that, then they don't need those manipulatives anymore. But they have to be able to explain it to you in their words. Rochelle?
I just have a question. It might be continued later, but seventh grade math, for example, I have to catch myself sometimes in thinking that, okay, I can't go back to second grade and teach them how to remultiply.
Mm-hmm.
So like, how do those...
You can. You have to. But you can do it like in the seventh grade format.
Yeah.
So in seventh grade, you're multiplying three digits by three digits. In second grade or third grade, they didn't learn the facts. Then you have to go back. You have to go back to that.
What does that mean? You have to go back and have them memorize the facts?
Oh, yeah, like... Pulling out the 10 block,
base
10 blocks?
Yes. Well, you know, single digit by single digit, you can use color tiles, you can use a whole lot of things.
Right.
By the time you get to two digit, then yeah, get those base 10 blocks back out.
Okay.
Because you can use them for decimals anyway. You can connect it to decimals.
And fractions.
And fractions. So, yeah. Any other questions, Pam?
No, I was just going to say, most of our kids don't know what a placeholder is. Like, what's a placeholder?
Mm-hmm.
And they
right.
still call it a placeholder.
Mm-hmm.
They have no idea what that is.
Or
yeah. what it's for. They just put X for
if students do not have a firm understanding of place value by the end of second grade, then they are confused about a lot of things for the rest of their mathematical career. So those second grade teachers are extremely important. So you fifth grade teachers need to be sure you're doing this vertical alignment stuff with those second grade teachers, well, all of them, but especially second grade. Because if they don't have that by the end of second grade, they're pretty much lost.
Mm-hmm.
Because, you know, multiplication, division, all of the things you have to do in third grade, they're not going to get a firm understanding of. And sometimes teachers who teach grades that are not tested do not understand the importance of some of these concepts that they just simply have to get before they leave that teacher. I'm sure y'all run into that, yes,
we run into that with the science teaks. The sixth grade, there is a chemistry strand, and what is missing, in fact, our science teaks are not good. They've got lots of holes in them, but one of the big holes that are in science is what we call the particle theory of nature. So in other words, particle theory of matter. That matter is not like syrup where it's continuous, but it's made of particles like sugar or salt or whatever. And the particles are elements. Element is a particle. An atom is a particle. Not the atomic structure. An atom, a compound, and a molecule are all particles. And that particle nature of matter must be taught in the sixth grade. Because it lays a foundation for the rest of physics and chemistry thereafter, and that's not in our teaks. So I highly recommend that you all start, science people, start going back to that a framework for K-12 science and start looking at what should be taught in those grade bands, in particle of nature of matter or particle theory of matter is pretty well explained in there. And just think about those four components being taught. And the IPC and chemistry teachers tell us they do not want the atomic structure taught, you know, electrons, protons, et cetera.
In middle school.
And they do not want periodic table taught because the kids come in confused. And it's a matter of trying to go beyond thinking that you're doing a good thing for students when that foundation is not being built, like the second grade idea that we're talking about with math.
Yeah.
And hitting things.
Mm-hmm. And yet I have seen the periodic table and the atomic structure in many, many science classrooms that I have visited over the years. Unless the science teachers have changed between 2001 and now. You're not alone in that your science teaks have gaps, because the new math teaks that came out in 2012, I think, are not nearly as strong vertically as the old math teaks. They have gaps. What grade level doesn't even talk about angles that we talked about?
Fifth
grade.
Fourth.
Okay, it talks about them in third and goes up to fifth, but fourth grade skipped it. So that makes absolutely no sense.
It's in fourth.
No, then it's fifth grade.
Then it's fifth grade.
One of those two.
No, okay.
It's not in there at all.
Is, what do you say?
It's taught in fourth grade, so fourth grade T.
Mm-hmm.
It's not, I don't think it's really in the fifth, it's not in the fifth grade expectations, but it's on the fifth.
That's interesting. So remember then we watched this little clip about Rachel. We're not going to watch it again. Rachel was a little second grader who had trouble subtracting when there was a zero there.
Mm-hmm.
Remember, 70 minus 24, she got like 54 doing the algorithm, but when she did it with the manipulatives, the base 10 blocks, and also linking cube, she got the correct answer.
Mm-hmm.
So
did not see that video clip in here?
I did not ring it. Well, we'll go back and show it again.
I have it. Maybe we could show it at lunch.
Sure. So I do need to tell you that the teacher did not teach her the standard algorithm. She went home and her father taught her that. her father not being a teacher taught her procedurally rather than conceptually, because, you know, he knew it. Okay, so we're going to talk about swimming pools. I was supposed to do this in January of this year, and we didn't get to it. So we're going to do it now. Have we done a little bit with swimming pools? Mm-hmm. Nothing at all? Okay, so we're going to start from the beginning. Huh? So we have three swimming pools here. We have pool one, pool two, pool three. And pool, they're all squares. Okay, so can you describe pool one to me? I've already called on her when I wasn't even supposed to. Sorry, Ashley, I will not call on you again. Candace.
There's another
pool one is the complete area of pool one looks like a 3x3 square.
Okay.
But
wait,
actual,
when you say 3x3,
mm-hmm.
do you mean?
There are three tiles for the length and three tiles for the width.
Okay, so there are three rows of three
yes.
tiles?
Yes.
Okay.
And then the pool itself, the water part, is only one square.
Okay.
Or one tile.
Okay. And pool two? You want me to call somebody? Don't get tired of talking, just tell me. Mm-hmm. Alyssa.
Pool two, right?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. Pool two has an area of 16 tiles. Well, the entire pool. The water has an area of 4 tiles.
Mm-hmm.
What else did you want to know?
Anything else you notice?
Visually, what I saw,
mm-hmm.
I don't even know if this is mathematical, but what I'm noticing from the first pool to the second pool, I'm seeing that first tile, and I just see three added, one on the top, one to the side, and one at the corner.
You see the blue tile of water, and you see three more added.
Yes.
Okay. And that's what any student would say. All right. And pool three? Quentin. Not too specific, because we hadn't done the lesson yet.
Pool three is has an area of 25 tiles where that you have 5 rows and 5 columns.
Okay.
The tiles along the outer edge of the pool are all red,
mm-hmm.
while the inner group of tiles are blue.
Okay. So Quentin, what is the blue representing? Since it's a pool.
The blue is representing water. I did have a question about this. I had a student last year who was colorblind. So what would you do for a student with using color tiles for something like this?
I don't know what to do about color tiles. If I gave her him or her a picture, you could hashtag, you know, these are little blind things.
Like a BGB or RR or something like that.
Or you just crosshatch.
Okay.
As for the color, the manipulatives,
just mark on a set.
You could write on them.
If you find out what colors it is that they can't see, then you could just use different colors. Like my nephew, the red and brown was the same, so red and brown is not a good combination, but if you use red and something else other than brown, it's
like red and white, they could tell the difference in a red and a white. Black and white would work.
Yeah.
Good idea. So if you know which student it is, the baggie of tiles that you give them would be those. All goes back to knowing your students, doesn't it? So, we have talked about pool one, two, and three. So, what do you think the next pool would look like? And I want you to think to yourself, that means no talking, for about 30 seconds, maybe 10 seconds. Since you're all teachers. And Melissa, what would the next pool look like? It's true, I really do.
I believe the next pool, pool four, would have 6 red blocks
mm-hmm.
per row,
mm-hmm.
per column, so 36
Sorry.
Square units
okay.
in the pool, in which case the outside ring, so a 6x6 picture frame, would be red,
mm-hmm.
and the inside would be blue.
Okay, because initially you said 6 red rows,
yeah.
and that's not what you meant.
Six rows. 6 rows of 6. Yeah.
And the outside would be red, because you corrected yourself later. Okay, so
Let's think about the quantities that are changing here. Okay, I want you to think about the quantities that are changing. What does the word quantities mean? Kids won't know that word, and they should. So you've got to tell them, Ashley D, what does the word quantities mean?
Just the number of the object you're looking at.
Okay, so quantities are numbers, right? Quantities are numbers. The number of what? What could we be talking about, though, actually, as changing?
Tiles, the number of tiles.
The total number of tiles. Mm-hmm. What else could we be thinking about as changing, Alyssa?
The color. The amount of tiles. So, for example, the amount of blue tiles they're changing, and so is the amount of the red tiles.
Okay, the number of blue tiles and the number of red tiles. So you want the word number in there. What else could we be thinking about this?
We could be thinking about the pattern of the amount of tiles changing.
Okay, the total number of tiles? Yes, we could. Okay, so there's lots of different quantities that are changing as we go up in our pool. So this is what we're going to do. With your table mates, you are going to create this square tile. I almost decided to let you create any rectangular pool that you wanted. And then I thought, no, for this kind of review day, we're going to keep it all the same because later we'll talk about the differences, all right? And you're going to consider these relationships, but you're all are not going to consider all of them. I'm going to assign these to groups, okay? So one group is going to be considering the pool number as compared to the tiles in the border, right? Another group will be considering the pool number. It all goes back to the pool number with the number of tiles in the actual pool, the blue, all right? Another group will be considering the pool number with the total number of tiles, the red and the blue. Another group, the pool number with the number of border tiles compared to the total tiles. So this is a ratio, right?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. And pool number, actual number of pool tiles, that's the blue, to the total tiles. And the last group, pool number with actual pool tiles compared to the number of border tiles. Okay? All right, so let's see who's going to do what. Let me think. I think A, I'll go pretty much in order. This will be group A. And we don't have six groups today, so I might let one group do two. So this group of four, five, if Sandra joins in, we'll do B. All right. C will be, who do I want C? This group, C, and then D and E. We'll skip F until the first one that finishes gets to do F. So that doesn't mean you have to take your time, okay? I'm teasing. So we'll just stop it at E, all right? So, listen to me carefully. Listen to me carefully. I'm not quite through yet. So you're going to consider these relationships. So the first thing you're going to do is to build the first five pools with the colored tiles. Okay. So you algebra teachers that already have an idea what you're doing, don't skip that step because remember you're learning how to do it with the kids. Okay. You're going to actually build the first five pools. All right. They don't have to be red and blue. They can be different colors as long as there's two different colors there. Okay. All right. That's the first thing you're going to do. Don't do that now. He has not held up the seven sides yet. That's good. Hang on just 1 minute. I can have your attention for just 1 minute. I failed to remind you the rules of the game. If you know the answer of anything, you cannot tell somebody. You can only ask questions. And remember, those questions cannot be leading questions. I do not want to hear you say, don't you think we should? Okay? Or why didn't you this? You have to ask those conceptual understanding building questions. All right? Okay.
I'm trying to unlock my. I just told you that. No, I've only had it out 2 weeks, but for some reason when I went to do notability, it says that. So I'm going to my email.
Okay,
well,
if you
want to
go over, it's okay.
It's okay.
People need hands on the tiles.